Hello students, welcome to our online class. We are taking our unfinished poem, Ecology. In this poem, we have tried to understand the text with any prior knowledge about the poet or about the theme of the poem. And in this process, we have found that if we read a poem a couple of times, two times or three times, we can understand the theme of the poem, we can understand what the poem is about, what the poet is talking about, and it is not necessary that we know all the things about who has written the poem or what is the subject of the poem. On our own, very patiently, very understandingly, if we make an effort to connect the imagery of the poem, remember, the lines in a poem do not run as in a prose. They are generally broken. So we have to find the connection. If we can do that, then we can understand the poem. I would advise you that you try to read the poem first. In our next poems, try to read the text of the poem first. Try to get at the meaning of the poem on your own. And then read the summary or read about the poet, about the poem from the book. Now, it is just a kind of revision because nothing is left in our this poem Ecology. But if you do not have the text or the book with you, our this section will help you. First of all, remember the name of the poet. In section A, often the question is asked about the full name of the poet. So remember full name of all the poets, all the writers, even in our prose section, in our second paper, try to remember full name of the writers. Our this A K Ramanujan, a very famous poet, but his name is Attipatte Krishnaswamy Ramanujan. Unfortunately, he died in 1993. And he is an Indian poet, obviously, a scholar who wrote in both English and Kannada. Ramanujan is a poet, a scholar, a professor by profession, philologist, folklorist, translator, and playwright. He was born in Mysore. In 1983, he was appointed the William E. Colvin Professor in the Departments of South Asian Languages and Civilizations of Linguistics and in the Committee of Social Thought at the University of Chicago. This is the place of his working, the University of Chicago. He worked there. At the University of Chicago, Ramanujan was instrumental in shaping the South Asian Studies program. He died in Chicago on 13th July 1993 as a result of an adverse reaction to anesthesia during preparation for surgery. So his name and his qualities, his abilities, we are to learn, remember these things. His poems are remembered as enigmatic works of startling originality. Enigmatic, difficult to understand. It is just like a puzzle. And our this poem, Ecology, is a good example of his this quality as a poet. Startling originality. He is always original in his theme, in his treatment of the subject. Even in the choice of words, he startles the reader. Sophistication and moving artistry. His artistry is just like the artistry work on ornaments. Very sophisticated, but very effective. His poetic works are Second Sight, published in 1986, Selected Poems, published in 1976, and The Striders, in 1966. In 1976, the government of India awarded him the Padma Shri. So he is Padma Shri awardee. And he received that prize, that award, in 1976. He received Sahitya Academy Award in 1999 for his poems, which was published under the title The Collected Poems in 1995. And that thing happened, unfortunately, posthumously. He was awarded Sahitya Academy Award after his death. Now we are in the section about the poem. This poem Ecology is taken from his Second Sight, published in 1986. the speaker seems to be the poet himself or some imaginary person who is loyally devoted to his mother. That thing is clear from the text of the poem that the person, the speaker, he is here, we find the first person speaker. So the speaker is telling his own experience and he is very much concerned about his mother. It may be the poet himself, it may be someone else, it does not make any difference. We take that I is used for poet himself. The poet himself is speaking. The poet has tried to show the difference in the views of people belonging to old generation, her mother, and those belonging to the new generation, he himself. The old people have emotions, memories, belief attached with everything in their life. This thing is related to the meaning which we have taken out after our reading the text. The text has the literal meaning, the meaning that is presented by the words, by the text itself. And then there is the hidden meaning. Then there is the real meaning. Why these things are described so? What is the purpose in saying these things? How something can be used or something has been used as a symbol? How words are taking us to somewhere else? If we do this exercise, and we can do this exercise on our second or third reading of the poem, then we can get this much of understanding that we can write these type of things which are not present directly in the text. But on reading the frequent reference to mother, mother's ideas, poet, poet's ideas, and then considering the title of the poem, we can say that there is a struggle in the poem. The mother wants to keep the champak tree in spite of the trouble it causes to her. And the son, he wants to remove the root of the trouble to his mother. And the only possible way of getting rid of that tree is to cut it. Mother does not agree on this proposal. And son is almost adamant, or for him, there is no other solution than cutting the tree. Why? Because the tree has no place in life of poet. It is only a troublemaker for him. Because his mother is not well with this tree. But for mother, it is a treasure of emotions. It is a treasure of memories. It has been a part, a companion for her. So we can find this type of contrast, this type of placing against two generations in the poem. The word ecology seems to convey the thought that a tree may have both negative and positive factors, and therefore it need not be pulled down. We should not destroy anything. If something is causing trouble to us, we should try to change our position, or we should try to adjust with it. The decision to destroy that thing completely should be the last option, and it should not be acted upon immediately. Because everything in nature, everything in our life has some value. It has some positive qualities. Maybe it brings some negative qualities also with it. But that does not mean that something is worthless, useless, if it is of no use for us. That may be, that is the meaning, the message conveyed in the poem. Again, we can reach to this type of understanding after reading the text completely, after trying to connect the images, after trying to connect the stanzas, why the poet had said something earlier, why he had said this thing now. If we try to do this exercise, obviously in our next poems, if you do on yourself, you will also be able to get at such type of understanding. Ecology. The poet says that for a number of years, during every first rain, he finds his mother suffering from blinding migraine because of the three red champak trees. Now this is the paraphrasing. We are trying to tell the poem in our own words. During the season, the red champak tree's flowers bloom, which then release yellow pollen grains in the air, which, according to the poet, spread like fog throughout the street, or in other words, throughout the area. The pollen grains remain suspended in the air and thus do not allow the wind to get pure. They are always in the atmosphere. You will have to inhale it. It remains filled with their fragrance. The wind, the atmosphere remains filled with the fragrance of the flower. In the next line, the poet says that no door can prevent the pollen from entering their black-pillared house. There is no way, no possible way of keeping those things out of their house. According to the poet, his house walls had ears and eyes, and scales and smells and bone creaks and nightly visiting voices, and in a sense, they were porous like humans. As with our eyes, we cannot stop seeing. With our ears, we cannot stop hearing. Anything that produces a sound, we hear it. Anything that is before our eyes, and if we keep our eyes open, keeping eyes open is just like a hole, then the scene will enter our eyes and we will get knowledge of that thing. We will sense that thing. Similarly, our house, the walls of our house, sense everything that is outside. Thus, the poet personifies the house, emphasizing that pollen grains are coming inside it through the holes, which are like the pores of human body. It is very much sensitive to the pollens as we are. The poet finally tells his mother that he is going to cut the tree, which flashes rage and anger on her face, which is full of sweat and pain due to migraine. So even at the time when the poet makes the proposal of cutting the tree, his mother is suffering from that migraine pain. But in spite of the presence of the pain, she is so sympathetic, so friendly to the tree. The poet compares her anger with the twisted silver and wet knickers of her grandchildren. That is a very typical image. We will discuss it in detail later. Thus, his mother's forehead is also twisted due to severe pain. So the proposal is made. Why not cut a tree? She tells the poet that the tree is as old as she is. This is the personal connectivity between the tree and herself. If you can think of cutting me, you can think of cutting the tree. Its seed was seeded by a passing bird's providential droppings. The tree was planted here not with any kind of planning. It was just by chance. It was will of God. It was work of God that He chose this place, our house, to seed that tree. The bird dropped the seeds of those plants as was will of God. So how we can take the decision of removing it from that place? She believes that the bird seeded the plants so that a line of cousins, or in other words, each new generation may be able to offer its basket full of annual flower to God in prayers, and also to their daughters. And for this reason, she is all prepared to bear with the pain of migraine. She will not agree with the proposal of the poet to cut the tree. I think this paraphrased information, we have got it very completely and satisfactorily only by reading the text itself. Because these things are conveyed in the text itself, we need not the prior knowledge about the theme or about the poet of the poem. This is our first step in reading the poem. Being students of literature, we should do and we must do some further exercise in analyzing the poem. Whether there are figures of speech, whether it has some use of symbols, some similes and metaphors, we should try to analyze those things. In our next class, I will take some typical imagery, some typical similes and metaphors from this poem. You are well aware of them. And we will try to explain, we will try to relate those things with the expected theme of the poem, that it is about the contrast between the ideology of two generations. It is about giving new understanding of usefulness of objects of nature, how those things are suggested which we have read in our earlier slides, that about the generations, that about the ecology, how we could get at those meanings. Those meanings are not super added, they are embedded in the text itself. So how can we get, how can we open those meanings, we will take in our next class. Till then, thank you, students.